بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على خير خلقه وخاتم نبيه المرسلين سيد الأولين والآخرين شفيع المسلمين رحمة للعالمين محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين صلوات
اللهم صل على محمد.
قال الله عز وجل في كتابه الكريم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون واتسموا بالحبل الله جميعا ولا تفارقوا صدق الله علي العظيم أما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته يا جميعا. The praise is Allah's. Those who speak cannot accurately express His true praises, nor those who count number His favors and blessings, nor those who try to dive into the inner recesses of His knowledge can reach the depths, save those whom He pleases. I openly bear witness that there is no God but Allah, that He has no partners and no associates, but He is absolutely alone, without the feeling of being lonely. And I also openly bear witness that Muhammad ibn Abdullah is a servant and messenger of Allah. In fact, he is the Qatun Nabiyun, he is the seal of all of the Anbiya. And I also openly bear witness that Ali, Amir al-Mu'mineen, Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad, is the friend of Allah, and he is Allah Azza wa Jalla's proof here on this earth. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, it is indeed an honor to have been afforded the opportunity to come before you today on this most solemn occasion in order to commemorate and honor this extraordinary personality we all have come to know by the name of Ash-Shahi Al-Haj Malik Al-Shabazz, also known as Malcolm X Shabazz, Rahimullah, Salawat. We thank Allah Azza wa Jalla and we praise Him for raising such an extraordinary personality as Al-Hajj from among ourselves. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, this seminar takes place at a time when momentous events are taking place not only here, but moreover throughout the world. So therefore today, dear brothers and sisters, we look back in history not to romanticize the past, but to draw lessons from the past and to bring what we have learned from the past into the present with what we already know, with the hope that we will be able to develop a better framework that will enable us to chart a better, brighter future for not only ourselves, but moreover, for the future coming Muslim generations, as well as humanity as a whole. One thing I just would like to say right off is that in this time, in this short time that we have, really, we can't really do true justice to the personality of Al-Hajj Malik Shabazz.
Come on, Shay.
Okay? Really, nothing that we can say today can really either raise his status or lower his status, because in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's eyes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed him on a high maqam. Okay, his position is fixed with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we can try to share a few of our thoughts and ideas and try to contribute in that way. Salawat.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
You know, another thing that I found very significant just right off is that, you know, when the Shahada of Al-Hajj Malik Shabazz took place, it was on a Sunday. And we're told that it was around 3:10 in the afternoon on Sunday. So I thought that would just be significant to point out. You know, I don't know if the organizers even realized it, okay, that it was actually on the Sunday. Even though this was the 19th and it happened on the 21st, I still think it's very significant. So that was one thing. Salawat. You know, primarily, the talk would be around three essential principles. You know, before Al-Hajj went back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, during his latter part of his life, particularly the last year and a half of his life, his focus primarily was on three things. And he referred to those three things as PPT. P, the first P, pledging unity. Second, promoting justice. Third, transcending compromise. You know, one of the ayahs that I opened up with today is actually from Surah Ali Imran, ayat 103, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the unity and to hold on to the Hablullah, hold on to the Hablullah, to the cable of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he says, all together, and do not be divided among yourselves, okay? When we look at the life of Al-Hajj, we see that this was a brother that understood the significance of unity, and that he traveled not only throughout this country, but all over the world trying to reestablish that unity, trying to resurrect that within the people and in the minds of the Muslims. And we see that this is not something that's outside of Islam, but it's, in fact, it is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have told us in the Quran. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about unity, brother, it's really, and sisters, it's really something that we don't have a say-so in. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the ayah, he says, hold on. That is a direct command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, all together, jamia, okay, and do not be divided. Now you see that this is a game that the kuffar has played on the Muslims, okay, this divide and conquer. And we see this right now today. This is not something new or a new development, okay? This is something that was going on 50 years ago, okay, during the time of Malcolm prior to that. And we see right now today, how many reasons and how many ways have we been split and divided? And we see that really, in reality, it is not to the believer's benefit that we be divided. In fact, it is to our benefit to unite ourselves. So one of the things I think we can take as a lesson today, when we look at our world today and what the Muslims are facing, what the Ummah is facing today, we see that we are being systematically attacked all over the world, here as well. We see that our brothers and sisters in Canada was making Salatu Maghrib, I believe, or Isha, and someone came into the masjid and murdered them while they were praying. So one thing, brothers and sisters, that I think that we should do, and this is something that we can learn from studying the life of Al-Hajj, is that we should have an emphasis on protecting the Ummah. And I mean a joint sutra among all the Muslims, okay? The safety and well-being of the Muslims has to become a primary thing. And that is something that we cannot depend upon someone else to do outside of the Ummah. Okay? Some people think that having cameras is enough. Well, I want you to know, when that attack happened into that masjid, dear brothers and sisters, they had cameras there. The cameras did not stop a committed devil that wanted to come in there and do harm to our brothers and sisters. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, it is actually an ayat that speaks to this, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the houses of worship are places that should be protected. That's all houses of worship. That's irrespective if they are Muslim or non-Muslim, be they Jews, be they Christians, be they Muslims. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and if you do not protect those houses of worship, that the people will come and they will pull them down, they will tear them down. And he puts that responsibility squarely on the shoulders of the believers. And so this is something that inshallah that we can establish among ourselves as believers, irrespective of what mathab you follow. irrespective of the fact that you may be Ahlul Sunnah and we may be Shia. We share the same Qibla. We have the same Quran. We make salat to the same Allah. There's only one Allah. We bear witness to that. That should be enough, dear brothers and sisters, to unite us. Now, when I talk about unity or we mention unity, we need to be realistic. It does not mean that you have to be in agreement with everything that each other say. But we should have be able to establish a common unity, a common understanding among ourselves on the protection of each other.
Come on.
Okay? On the welfare of each other. We should be able to come together on that irrespective of what school of thought we follow. Okay? And irrespective, even if the person is Muslim or non-Muslim. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says all houses of worship should be protected. It should be a safe zone. You should not have to come into your place of worship and worry about if somebody's gonna come and do harm to you.
Come on.
Okay? So that's one thing. The next point that Malcolm mentions, Rahimullah, that is on propagating justice. Okay, the three letters, PPT. Promoting unity, propagating justice, and transcending compromise. Okay, the next point we will speak about is promoting justice. This is something that was in the blood of Al-Haj Malik Shabazz. You know, in one of his quotes he says, if a man fails to stand up for something, he will fall for anything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, he says, stand up for justice. In the Quran. And he says, even if it's against your own selves, okay, stand up for it. And when you look at the life of Al-Haj, we see that this was a brother that went all through this world, all over this planet, standing up for the justice and for the oppressed, and speaking out. And he put his life on the line, okay? He put his blood on the line for you and I, dear brothers and sisters. He didn't do this for any money or any fame, okay? Because when he left this world, he didn't leave this world a rich man, okay? But he did it because of his love and his commitment to people, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to the people. Salawat.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Another point is this here. Many of the Muslims, and it's a shame to say, but this is the reality. It is high time we stop living our lives in isolation. Because the enemies of Islam have used that to their benefit against us. We are satisfied with being with our own groups for the most part, whatever part of the world we come from. And we will conduct and continue our lives in that way. But this is time, dear brothers and sisters, to come out of that cocoon and to join, okay, and to unite ourselves with the rest of humanity, okay? Because Islam is the true brotherhood of man. That is the reality. Islam is the true brotherhood of man. And this is something that Al-Haj Malik Shabazz, he knew this. And he went from here to across the planet expressing this and also internationalizing the plight of the oppressed. You know, he not only went to Hajj, you know, we focus a lot about the fact that he went to Hajj. Alhamdulillah, he answered the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he went on Hajj. But he also went all out throughout the Middle East and through Africa, okay? And we're told that he met with over 33 leaders of the African states, okay? And he got from them a commitment. And he also explained to them the responsibility that they had and they owe to us, that they owe to humanity, that they owe to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because we as individuals, we are placed in this world, okay? And it appears to be a world of duality. But in reality, it is a singularity. It is a oneness, a connection that we have with each other. And it is our job as human beings, okay, to penetrate the veil of this duality and to see each other's humanity, irrespective of how much money you have, what part of the world you may be or come from, understand that we have a connection. Inshallah. Salawat.
Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar, wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al-aliyyi al-azim. I'm very honored to be able to give this presentation today. I look around the room, I always remember in my days of Islamic activism from the 70s, I was always the youngest man in the room. And I've always been the youngest man wherever I went. But now I look around everywhere I go, I'm always the oldest man in the room. And the ballot or the bullet is one of the major speeches that have become historically part of the American fabric for progressives and revolutionaries and people of conscience and goodwill from every background. And because I'm the oldest man in the room, I think I should put this in context. What was happening there in 1964 in Detroit, where he delivered this speech in April 1964, there was kind of a showdown in the black community. You know, you had the what they call the civil rights movement. MLK, may Allah bless him, preached a nonviolent type of approach to the problems, that nonviolence would show the lack of morality and the inhumanity of your oppressor, and you're going to overcome him with love. And we're going to sing We Shall Overcome, and all kinds of white and black people are going to hold hands together to show unity and diversity. Whereas Malcolm's people were more like, if you step on me, I'm going to bite your leg off. And there was more of a market among the youth, if you will. I hate to use the word market. But the marketing of his message was such that he excited to the bone the revolutionary people of this country, including those outside of his immediate racial demographic. I remember in Syracuse, well, see, I don't want to get off track. I only have a few minutes. But he preached a form, as the Nation of Islam was promoting, a separation, that if black people in America could separate instead of integrate, this was the context of what he was going through. So he would also take the liberty to tell his people that they're being duped, and they're just like, they've been had, they've been took, they've been bamboozled. He tells his own people this, that they've been fooled by a system that doesn't mean any good for them. He even called his people on many occasions. He said, for instance, there are a couple quotes in here I'll try to get to, that you put the Democrats first. See, this is the other thing. Well, they had the Democrats and the Dixiecrats. The Dixiecrats were the Democrats from the South. And it wasn't until our sister Cynthia McKinney told me about 20 years ago how Lee Atwater in the Reagan administration is the one who went to the Dixiecrats, the Southern Democrats, and they told them, what are you doing voting alongside the blacks? You should be with us, with the Republicans. And since then, the South has become all red states because they turned the Dixiecrats into Republicans. Okay, that's another thing. So he said to his people, you put the Democrats first, and they put you last because you're a chump.
Oh, yeah.
That's in the same speech, in the same ballot or bullet. Listen to it. Go to YouTube, put Malcolm X, the ballot or the bullet. He tells his own people, you're taken advantage of, and then he tried to make them feel bad because, and he said also, the concept of black nationalism is very important. And many of our people I like to call from the Bani Hashim. Bani Hashim is what? Bani Hashim is the mass of black people in America who happen not to be Muslims. But it is their protection, their humanity, that underwrites our existence in prosperity in this country, and survival even. Dr. Sherman Jackson, one of my heroes, said that you Muslims, especially the Muhajirin, the so-called immigrant Muslims, you cannot have the idea that your story in America began in 1965 when the government was forced because of the bloodshed of the black people that were hanging from trees, not just a few miles from here. They had to change the rules of the government that anyone could come from the so-called third world and people of color. Up to that point, 1965, only white people with direct roots to Europe were allowed to emigrate to America. I remember an article that Dr. Bilal Mansa Bilal King from Morehouse sent me, because he likes to pick on me, I'm from Lebanese background, and he sent me a long article, the title of which is How the Syrians Became White. And in 1915, 102 years ago, in Charleston, South Carolina, there was a Syrian guy. I think he was Christian. and he wanted to get his, you know, passport. And at that point in 1915, that's 50 years before the law changed. You could only apply for citizenship if you were either the progeny of the slaves or you had white direct roots to Europe. And it was that 20-year legal fight that made the Syrians white. Okay? I remember my own father, 1939, 10 years before I was born, there was a quote in our newspaper in Worcester, Massachusetts. My own father, before he went off to World War II, they were trying to categorize the Lebanese. You know, we had a big church in Syrians and Lebanese, and I was in the Syrian Orthodox Church. And I was raised there in Worcester, Mass. And the newspaper interviewed my daddy 10 years before I was born. Because the government, the Census Bureau, was having a tough time. How do you categorize these? They're not white. They're not black. You know, yeah, some of them are like white looking. Others in my church look like you guys, you know. And so they're all in the same, you know, all Lebanese. So my father said, look at me. Call us white. Look at me. Who could be more white than me? That's my own father. So that was part of that struggle. So anyway, this particular speech, I know my time is fleeing. I'm just going to hit you with a few. I took copious notes on this, but in general, the black nationalism philosophy, he tried to get the African-American mass to follow him by saying, look, leave your religion at the door. You're a Christian, I'm a Muslim. Hey, let's not talk about religion. Let's talk about opening and running the businesses in our own community. Instead of having a community where people who don't look like us, well, back then it was different groups, you know, we like to say, especially we politicized Americans, we say for 5 or 10 years it was the Vietnamese, then it was the, you know, the Bosnians, or then it was the Iraqis, or then it was someone, the Koreans, you know, everyone comes in here from all over the world. I personally know, because of my white privilege, I personally know some Koreans who told me that the conversation back in South Korea, Seoul, South Korea, many of them talked to each other about, oh, if only I could get to America and become rich by selling hot wings to black people. This is their agenda, because they know they can go into the hood and open up a shop and sell hot wings. I don't know why the black people in that area don't do it. They could probably do it too, but they don't do it. The Koreans come and they do it. So we talked about black nationalism. We have to control the economics and the politics and the culture of to control our own community. He hit on integration versus separation. We need to have separation, and of course, this is something we can talk about as Muslims. He talked about the potential that if black people back then started these businesses, they could become, you know, global corporations. It's not happened except in a few areas of entertainment and sports. He said to his people, if it's 1964 and it's this late, see, now it's really late, it's 2017. But in 1964, if you're still standing there singing, "We Shall Overcome," it means that the government has failed you. And the people said, he said to them, you need to stop singing and start swinging. He said, Muhammad Ali didn't become the world champion by singing, he became the world champion by swinging. And the colonialism story was ending, you know, nationalism was coming all over. Nationalism was what overthrew colonialism in Africa and Asia and the Middle East, not standing there, "We Shall Overcome." Liberty or death. He said that the idea of a block vote among black people. Now we could extend that to all people of color or all Muslims or all whatever. Since the white vote is evenly split, see, that's the thing. Unfortunately, a lot of our people don't register, they don't vote. Oh, what vote, what difference? It's only one vote. No, man. If you get 3,000 people to vote as a block, you can sway any election because the white vote is split. So the minority, so-called minority, becomes a huge, you know, these are the points he talks. And he says, you march between two dead men, between, the other context, that was the March on Washington that MLK had just successfully done, right? And so he came down on those people who thought that they were on the cutting edge of the revolution. He said, no, you guys walked from one dead man, Lincoln, to another dead man, Washington, holding hands, singing, "We Shall Overcome." And they all, you know, they all laughed and clapped and everything. He had a very powerful way to work a room. The South mentality, people think that the South is more racist and anti-black than the North. He said, man, if you're south of the Canadian border, you're in the South, okay? Don't call George Wallace, the racist governor of Alabama, who said, segregation now. segregation tomorrow, segregation forever, right? And then later in his life, he changed in defense of George Wallace. I can't believe my mouth is in defense of George Wallace.
Yeah, I know.
Well, yeah, he said, you know, when he was ready to die, he said, no, this black man is my best friend, you know, from his hospital bed, you know. So. But he said, Malcolm said, don't call George Wallace a Dixiecrat, Dixie governor. Romney is a Dixie governor. And Romney was, of course, the father of Mitt Romney, who was the governor of Detroit, where I met my lovely wife up there in 1968. She's still sitting at home 49 years later. And so, segregation, yeah, and about the lynching. I mean, this man had a way, a magnetic way to work a room. He said, they lynch you in Texas, and the same as they lynch you in Mississippi. The only difference is they lynch you in Texas with a Texas accent, and they lynch you in Mississippi with a Mississippi accent. That's why it's going to be the ballot of the bullet. And finally, my last point, he said, the first thing they do when they get in office, like these presidents, don't take this the wrong way, brothers and sisters. I can see the headlines tomorrow. He said, the first thing they do when they get in office, they invite the Negro leaders for coffee to show that I'm all right. And then he said, the Uncle Toms can't pass up the coffee. Pass up the coffee. And look what happened with the orange president, man. You know, he invited, you know, those guys, you know what I'm talking about. Yeah, they went up there and sipped the coffee. A'udhu billah. Ladies and gentlemen, jazakallah khair, wassalamu alaikum.
It's difficult to surmise Malcolm in a few words. It's almost, in my opinion, disrespectful to come behind Malcolm and try to talk about Malcolm, because nobody could do Malcolm like Malcolm. Mm. Malcolm is my catharsis. Mm. The word catharsis is a beautiful word. It's a word that means that thing that brings you contentment, that thing that brings you happiness. If I'm sad, I listen to Malcolm. If I need to get revved up so I can be a revolutionary, I listen to Malcolm. If I need to love myself, I listen to Malcolm. And sometimes when we listen to Malcolm, we need that red, hot fire Malcolm. But if you listen to his tone here, it's calm. It's easy. He's given us something. He makes you lean in. He makes you lock eyes. He makes you conscious of what it is that he's trying to say. Some people who don't know Malcolm would say when they listen to that clip, oh, Malcolm was just talking about those black Muslims. But if you go back and you listen to Malcolm's history, there was a question about the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and some people, you know, we'll talk about that term honorable one day when you want to. But someone said, this Honorable Elijah Muhammad is not a Muslim. The Muslims say that he's not a Muslim. And Malcolm said, what are you talking about? The Muslims, as my brother said, are united. What Muslim says that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad is not a Muslim? So when Malcolm said that America has looked at the Muslim and turned them into someone that's violent, he wasn't just referring to the black Muslims, he was referring to all Muslims. This is when you understand who Malcolm X really was. But what he said so long ago, if I played it like we played it just then, you would think that he saw what was going on right now today. Instead of them saying the word violent, they say that we are the fundamentalists, that we are the terrorists. And because we are the terrorists, now there needs to be a ban on the Muslims. What they do is, it's like the little child who goes out to fight. You know, the little imp. He goes over, he punches a kid in the face. He runs over to the teacher. Hey, look, he's trying to fight me. Why? Because the little kid who got hit is angry now. So everyone is saying, look how angry this kid is. In the Islamic world, people are hitting us in our faces. And when we go out to retaliate, look how bad they are. This is psychological warfare. What I put here is propaganda made Muslims the enemy. Since 1991, I'm going to say 1991 because I was a full consciousness in 1991. Back in 1979, I was a kid. I really didn't understand. I saw it up front, but the propaganda was not against the Muslims at the time. It was the Iran hostage series. They didn't say Muslims. They didn't put Islam in there. But in 1991, 92, going into 93, when we went over to the Gulf War, this real propaganda machine came in. Because it was at that time that the face of Islam no longer was a black face, but they put the face of the immigrant on American Islam. See, because here in America, Americans could not look out and say, look at the black people, because we are Americans. They already knew us. We had a sunnah. We weren't going out there bombing nobody. We weren't going out there killing nobody. You cannot call the black Muslim in America a terrorist. But when you change the face and you made them into something that was foreign, you change the psyche of the whole country. And because of that, right now, when it comes down to Muslims, black Muslims don't even get a second thought. Malcolm understood that this is not a war of me going to get a gun and fighting you. He has elevated it to where it's a game played with your mind. It's where they give you an image, they give you smoke, they give you mirrors. How do we destroy the smoke in the mirrors? As Muslims, it becomes our job to stand up front and to let them know who we are, what we do, how we do it, and when it's time to stand up with people who are standing up against injustices. See, what Malcolm did before he died was, Malcolm said, I don't care if you white, purple, blue, polka dot, if you are standing up against injustice, I am standing up against injustice with you. This is lost on a lot of people. So today, as I think about this man who brings me a great deal of honor, who gives me a great deal of contentment, I say to all of you, go back. Check what he was really all about, because you will learn the tactics that people were using then and are using now. And if we use with the tools that he was trying to give us then, the tools will work right now. So I'd like to thank each and every one of you for giving me the opportunity to expound just a little bit on Malcolm. And if I did him any injustice, I beg for your forgiveness. Thank you very much.
I was born in 1949. You know, when I was born, I was very young. And then it was all downhill from there. So I was like, what, 15? I was 16 when he was killed. I was still, you know, listening to the Beatles and the Rolling Stones. It was just a few years later when I went to university in 67, 68, and I realized who he was. He had already been killed in 65, February 21st. Yeah, COINTELPRO was a very big deal because Syracuse University, where I went, was a stronghold of the Black Panther Party. And the COINTELPRO, which for those of you who might not know, means it's a abbreviation for counterintelligence program. We had a director of the FBI, J. Edgar Hoover, who said that the biggest threat to national security, see little Muhammad over here, Muhammad Hussein, would you stand up please? Would you let them see you? See this little kid here? In Oakland, California, little black kids were going to school poor kids with no breakfast, and they couldn't learn, couldn't concentrate. Thank you. In the words of J. Edgar Hoover, the biggest threat to national security was to feed little black kids in Oakland, California. Imagine that. What kind of shaitan was that? And so they would purposely create plots to make one group of African Americans fight the other group, you know, and divide and conquer is what Sheikh Ali mentioned earlier. And this is what happened. And I think that the spirit of protest after this 1975, when the Vietnam War ended, then you had the years of Carter and Reagan and all that, things kind of went to sleep. And we kind of, activists and politicized people, were kind of disappointed that this has all gone to bed. But then a few years ago, you had that Occupy movement. And now you got, you know, we had 8 years of a black president. Now we got an orange president. And I think the orange president is unifying all of those factions, all those people that have been sleeping. Sister Linda Sarsour, who spoke at the CARE event last night, was one of the three or four main organizers of this. Millions of women and others who came, well, women and men, can't say women and others, but, you know, mostly women, who came the day after the inauguration. And she's working with all kinds of wide variety of groups and groupings, and there's all kinds of coalitions being built. So I think, this, to answer the question in a nutshell, I'm optimistic in the years of Trump that the spirit of resistance will come again and rise to the top. Otherwise, we're all toast. Because right now they're trying to, this guy, this real shaitan, Ted Cruz, he's trying to introduce legislation declaring the Muslim Brotherhood and any affiliated organizations as terrorist organizations. And now with their twisted mind and their hateful position, they're going to, after they pass that through, then they're going to say that every group, ISNA, ICNA, you know what I mean, CARE, you name the group, El Rasul Center, they're going to say that every group is related to the Muslim Brotherhood and therefore should be shut down. So we need to get ready to push back on steroids, okay?
Assalamu alaikum. I was alive when when Malik Shabazz went back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And two things I want to mention. And one of those is, and this is something that, you know, a lesson that we can learn from the past. And that is, the kuffar, you know, the way they mind work. And it worked like that then, and it's worked like that today. And that is, too often, when it comes down to our leadership, that when we build movements, the movements is built around personalities. Okay? And we get into this whole personality worship. Not worship them like we worship Allah, but we get this attachment. And they know, if you kill the head, the body is going to die, okay? So we have to evolve out of that mindset, okay? Not attach ourselves to the personality, but attach ourselves and commit ourselves to the principles that personality may have espoused. And we have to embody that and pass that on, because it has to be a continuum, okay? Not just a movement. A movement has a beginning and has an end. But a struggle is a continuum. And we have to develop that among ourselves. Second thing is that, alhamdulillah, as Sheikh Hanifa, I believe, touched on. And that's this. And this is very important. The criminalization of Islam. Forget about the name of an organization and all of that. These people have criminalized Islam, okay? So when you criminalize Islam, all Muslims are suspect, okay? I read an article a few days ago where that some of these Catholics from these think tanks that they have are actually trying to push forward a bill, okay? And in this bill, they have also mentioned something that they are saying now, that there's no moderate Muslims, okay? So everybody that thinks that they're moderate, if you're a Muslim, okay, you're a potential threat, okay? So the criminalization of Islam is very real, okay? And you know, and we can sit back and think that everything is going to take care of itself if you want to. Before you know, you know, you can wind up, you know what I mean, you're in a box, because they already have put us in a box, okay? But we have to stop reacting to things that is happening to us externally, and we have to become proactive, okay? Alhamdulillah, when we saw this ban they tried to put in effect, we seen thousands of people across the country, and even on an international level, came out against it. They was with us. I seen Christians standing out there with collars on saying, put my name in the register, put me as a Muslim. Because the reality is, dear brothers and sisters, okay, if we don't wake up, okay, and understand that we have a responsibility to come up out of these corners, come up out of these masjids, okay, not just be satisfied with that, and to begin to unite and link ourselves and form relationships with other people, we're going to be finished.
As-salamu alaykum, everybody. I thank you all for the invitation from the Wilat Foundation, from the Rasul Center. It's an honor to be here, and my apologies. I'm embarrassed to make this my first visit here, but I know many of you from other occasions and other instances, and it's very nice to see everybody again. I want to start out by cueing something that Sheikh Ali Sharif brought up at the very beginning of his talk, and that is the intentionality behind, you know, recalling the memory or the legacy of particular figures in our community. Whether this is for a living sort of saint that we have today, or a saint from our contemporary period like Al-Hajj Malik Shabazz, or from the awliya and the great figures of our history, okay? The imams, the awliya, even the anbiya, okay? All of these figures, like Sheikh Ali said, they should not simply be recalled upon for some kind of nostalgia, all right? We should not consider them only for the purpose of remembering a time gone by, a gone past, some sort of bygone era. How many of you are familiar with this sort of complex of nostalgia that we have in our communities, right? Everywhere you go, we're always quick to talk about the Abbasid Empire, the great inventions of the Baghdad, the Dar al-Hikmah, and the Ottoman glassmaking, and the kind of publications that we used to have. And we always talk about things as if they're lost to us. But one of the greatest structures of Islamic civilization writ large, what I mean is something that is embedded in every single one of our groups. And I know that that we don't like to talk about the fact that we're split into so many groups, okay? But the fact is that we have multiple branches and leaves. And there's a beauty in that, and there's a hikmah in that. But one of the most stable things about this feature of ikhtilaf that we have in our community, and firaq in our community that we have, one of the most amazing features is that we're still a tree. And what I mean by that is that the farthest leaf that's out there will be connected physically to the branches, to the trunks, and to the roots. And in our community, those links are not just aqidah and fiqh and our salawat, but they're actually in our human relationships. Sheikh Ali, we were just cueing your note about not being simply nostalgic about the past, but instead trying to bring this into the future for us. And so one of the most amazing features is this connection that we have that is beyond just our surface level, you know, rituals, aqidah, things like that, but instead through our actual social relations. And what I mean, that this is burnt into every branch of Islam that we have out there, okay? We have amongst the Ahlul Bayt, okay, and the systems of leadership and taqlid and community that we have there, we have a way to get from this masjid all the way back to Najaf, Karbala, and Mecca and Medina. So I don't have to explain the logic behind that, right? Every Sufi tariqah in this planet looks at their shuyukh the same way. They connect through bayah and ijazah all the way back. Our learning, our tafsir of the Quran, the way that we teach our children, okay? Anything that we have gets handed down through an ijazah system. Okay, a verification. It's the human beings through which we're connected to the past. It's one of the most beautiful features that we have. It's not like anything else in the rest of all of religion, where you have a disconnected set of ideas or philosophy and then some group just practicing it. No. The way that we practice our tradition regardless of what branch you're in, is by being connected to the people who have inherited it and carried it on and passed it forward and built the institutions to do that. So, what happens when a leaf falls from the tree? And I'm going to get a little bit autobiographical here. I actually don't know if I've ever talked about this in public before. But many of you that I'm friends with personally know that I have a very interesting sort of mixed background. I was born in Taos, New Mexico, to a Chicana mother and an Iranian father, okay? Now, my mother was from villages in northern New Mexico that were actually descendants of the early Spanish, you know, conquistadors and settlers, all right? That's who we are on my mother's side. I was raised in a household where both of my family, they had had enough of their sort of religious backgrounds. Why? My mother came not from a Catholic background, but she came from a small minority background. Very rare to have Hispanic Pentecostals at the time. You all know Pentecostal religious tradition?
Oh, yeah.
They're the Shiites of the Christians, right? Right? You guys get it, right? And my father, alhamdulillah, comes from Yazd, okay? And you guys know Yazd is Shia, right? Okay? So they both, I think, had a little bit enough of the kind of institutional religion that they were brought in. They did not raise us in a non-religious household, but they didn't give us any structure or guidance onto what we should be practicing. Instead, we had a Fatiha on the wall, we had a Lord's Prayer on the other wall or something like this, and I was something of a leaf thrown from the tree, okay? I believed firmly in God, but what the nature of that God was or anything like this, I had very little idea. It wasn't until college, late high school, college years, that I began to explore my interests in religion and belief. But at that time, I'm being raised in Colorado, a suburb of Denver, Colorado, okay? There's no Iranian community out there. And when I show up, I can't speak Farsi. I don't know this or that between prayer, fasting, or anything. If it was Ramadan, I didn't know that it was Ramadan. You know, that's the kind of... So who do I relate to coming to try to break from my sort of American lifestyle, American habits, and everything that goes along with that, to try to adopt an Islamic lifestyle? There weren't any Chicano, you know, Muslims around. There were a couple in Chicago I visited, but that wasn't doing much for me. Okay, Alianza Islamica in Harlem, visited them, but that wasn't doing much for me. The Iranians, again, that's a hard world to enter. Many of you guys know this, right? So who is it that took me in and embraced me and cultivated me in my deen, other than my black American Muslims? Okay, and it was them who guided me and nurtured me and reared me into this deen. And all of my foundational elements of what I know to be Islam came from that community. And it is absolutely a dedication and service, a real sort of service project of gratitude and humility that inspired this project called the After Malcolm Project. And the point was to not be nostalgic over somebody like Al-Hajj Malik Shabazz Malcolm X, to think about him, because I did have his autobiography, the Quran, and dare I say in public, the tafsir of Sayyid Qutb, okay? All together on my nightstand, and that's what augmented my deen, okay? Stories of personal transformation, dedication, living revolution, okay? Those are the things that motivated me into this deen. And so I showed up here in 2004, 2005, and right around that time, an institute out of DC asked me to convene a focus group on African-American Muslims here. They were doing a Gallup poll, like a Pew report, you know, something like this. It was one of these studies that came out in 2006-07. It's the first time I got to meet the great Zainab Ansari, daughter of the great Mansour Ansari here in front of us. And we worked together, we convened a number of leaders and community members from the African-American Masajid to ask how they would, you know, think about certain questions and ideas in order for them to develop a poll for Gallup and Pew to conduct over the phone and things like this. And I walked into the back of the Al-Atlanta Masjid of Atlanta Masjid of Al-Islam. You're all familiar, right? I walk into the back, and if you guys, brothers know, everybody knows Brother Hassan back there of Taqwa Productions, all right? It's a brother always filming. And so I walk into the back room, it's about half the size of this room, and from the floor to the top ceiling, there are old videotapes, okay? Even those old, what do they call them, beta tapes? You guys remember that? Okay, there's cassette tapes thrown here that way. I'm getting a PhD at Emory. And I said to myself, you know, every single receipt and flyer and any little tag of anything from the civil rights movement has been preserved in this country. But why don't I know anything about the history of these communities. I mean, if you go to just study what are the documentary histories of this community, we can't find them. We don't have old videos. We don't have it. I mean, there's no museum doing this stuff. Nobody's paying for that. Obviously, they're not going to pay for it, right? All right. So I made a small dua at that time. I said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if I ever get to an institutional position where I can help preserve this information, I will. You know, and I, you know, you just do those kind of things sometimes. And subhanAllah, Zainab, Mansour's daughter, enrolled into Georgia State University when I started teaching there. It was around 2011, 2012. I said, Zainab, I got this project in mind. We got to go interview a bunch of people that are our elders because they're passing away. And we got to try to preserve their documents. I went to Sheikh Mendez for some guidance on this one. Got his buy-in from the very, very beginning. All right. Bilal King from Morehouse said he'd jump in and help guide this thing. But I didn't want to get started until we had the right, you know, the kind of right ingredients in place. Zainab took about 9 months, and then she said, let's do it. And so we started. And what we did is we just tagged our personal connections. And that's what's amazing about this. A leaf can be connected back to the tree very, very quickly. All right. And Mansour, through his network, I don't know how many people realize this, but the Islamic Party of North America, very few people really even know that it existed, all right? But one of the great transformational figures of Black American Islam and Islam in general in this country is brought in by the mentor of many people in this room, Muzaffaruddin Hamid, you know? And his children are amongst us here. And his children are leaders in the community, and the scholars, you know, and whatnot. And we have very little documentation about this. So we started doing oral histories. All right, and what do? We got the university to leverage its resources, okay? Top-notch film equipment, okay? Digital archiving at the library. And we just got help from wherever we could. Then who else do we have? The Atlanta Masjid of Al-Islam, you understand, is really the flagship institution of the late Waratheen Muhammad, all right? This is where you see it pan out. Imam Jamil, flagship institution, the absolute fruit of the Dar al-Islam, okay? All of these things were happening here underneath our nose in Atlanta, and it was amazing to me that we didn't have this information, we didn't have this history. So we worked for about 2 years, very, very hard, to get out there and build some documentation of this, and we started the After Malcolm Project. I apologize for the sort of quality of this. We can't see focus so well, but what we did is, again, we conducted oral histories. We have, I don't know, about over 40 of them or so, and focusing mostly on leadership or elderly folks in that area from as many communities as possible, as different as possible. We are trying to stay very far away from the question of whose Islam is correct, you know, instead trying to understand that we do only pray to one Qibla. And I would propose and challenge anybody, let us come up with a network of meetings and organizations, something loose, nothing new, just something loose, to call it the One Qibla meeting, you know, where we could get down and sort of really talk about these things together to overcome some differences, or at least, maybe not overcome them, but at least figure out a way to deal with them in the proper adab of ikhtilaf. But the real product of this thing is to document certain pieces of information that have absolutely been lost to history. What you're looking at here is a digital rendition of the Al-Islam newspaper, which ran for 8 years. It was the product of the Islamic Party of North America. The editor happened to be a friend of Mansour's over here and others, Ibrahim Hanif, South Carolina, that we're all happy he's doing well and healthy. I just saw that he's gonna be traveling now. And so, alhamdulillah, that's nice. And you have to understand that for a historian and a scholar, the most important piece of information is the actual evidence. This was gone. This was simply in the brother's garage. This is the only existing run of this newspaper. And through our personal networks and through trust and relationship building, he came down, spent a whole day with us, brought the newspaper, loaned them to us. I got the university to donate time and energy to digitize it, to put it online, make it publicly available, and now it's available for anybody who wants to go back and understand that history, teach their children about it, and understand what the ideas were and the thoughts were at that time. Why would that help? Because we need to bring them into the present, okay? We need something to connect us to that spirit of the Malcolm X spirit that everybody wants to talk about. Well, the connections are there, they're alive, the branches are there. And so we have to be able to get back to them. We have a number of other things that are held in the in the project, besides simply the newspapers, through, again, personal connections, we have here a audio file of a radio show that was called The Arrival of Truth, that was broadcast out of Cleveland underneath the leadership of Imam Mutawif Shahid, if anybody's familiar with this. I don't know how else to introduce Imam Mutawif for those who don't know him, other than to say that, you know that stereotype of the hard black Muslim in prison? All right? That stereotype, he invented that, okay? No, but I mean it literally, because he, before Attica, okay, before anybody else was talking about black Muslims in prison, he was authorized for the first state-sanctioned legal black Muslim chaplaincy program in the entire country, okay? Lost history, all right? What he did in the Ohio prison system was incubate the Darul Islam into a sort of institutional network that then traveled around the country and established jamaats all over the country. The Cleveland branch and the Ohio branch, I'm not saying anything about our brothers from the Northeast and New Jersey and Philly and New York, but it's that branch that spread the Dar across the country, okay? Imam Mutawif shows up in one paragraph, in one book about Islam in America, all right? Absolutely undocumented history. Part of the reason I don't think he talks to many people, but we have Imam Talib Abdul Rashid up in New York, successor to Sheikh Ahmed Tawfiq, okay, successor to Malcolm X. Trusted us. I mean, why? But he's not trusting me. He's trusting us as a community and the people that brought the After Malcolm Project out there to loan us their newspapers for digitization and preservation, okay? Imam Mutawif sent all the programs and the documents and the letters from that prison program I was telling you, the chaplaincy program, sent them to us, we documented them, we put them online, okay? It's a gold mine of stuff. Imagine the kinds of activities you could do with your children, all right, as a community, as an educational program, so we could inculcate each other from oral histories doing these together. We could teach our children the materials that were taught to us, okay, and our elders. There are ways to build our community through those links, through these materials. And I hope that the scholarship that I, you know, that I can cultivate isn't simply a scholarship for the academic community, but a scholarship for everybody. And the truth is if I could share, we promised everybody that anytime that they give us an oral history or a document or anything like this, we would get it up online immediately, and that we wouldn't be publishing these materials on our own, or we wouldn't be sort of pursuing some kind of academic agenda elsewhere. So I haven't published anything on this material. It's been 3 years. And because I believe it was an amana of sorts, you know? And so this is sort of the energy that's gone behind it. We do have a brother, Amir Muhammad. I don't know if many of you are familiar with Amir Muhammad from the Atlanta Ambassador of Al-Islam, good close colleague of mine. He's a documentary filmmaker. And we compiled a small documentary out of the oral histories.
It made 1, 2, 3, 4 of us.
It's Imam Mutawif. This is the small group that set up the West End Masjid before Imam Jamil even converted to Islam.
No. The bow ties and the regimentation is just different regiments. So I still continue to look until I found another Sunni, which just so happened to be a small
one. So, one of the things that's amazing to me is, if I could dare say, the spirit of Islam that resides in a particular moment in history. You guys see the ayah that is being referred to here? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala won't change the people until they change the condition themselves? Okay. Why is it that I see that ayah pop up in South Africa amongst people that are committed to the Islamic movement, right? Why is it that I see that thing popping up all over the place, leaves, not connected by branches, but connected by something else? And what I'm trying to say here is that we have a community. We have a community that's dedicated to a particular vision of Islam as personally, socially, and politically revolutionary. And we have resources to get us to the next stage of our development if we embrace our complex history, not so nice all the time, It's just like family, where if you get, you know, you can only sit together so long before things get coming out, right? But if you can get through the dinner and the dessert and the next day, we're good. And we have to be able to build that kind of space with one another. The After Malcolm Project is sort of a small contribution in that direction. And inshallah, with the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we can continue the work. I'll be honest with you, we're phasing out a little bit because the work is hard. And it's time consuming, it's laborious. It doesn't require as much money as anybody would ever imagine, but it requires commitment, dedication, cooperation. And we're happy to make the university available and our time and energy is available, but we really can't do it alone. And the kind of risks that people put out there to dedicate their time and energy to projects like this, they're substantial, and we need a lot of buy-in, and we need bodies to show up, to conduct the interviews, to record, to upload, to edit, you know what I mean? To convince the person, it might take 5 hours, that we're not spooks. That if you pass away, which you might in the next couple years, that your grandkids aren't taking care of those newspapers in the library. You know what I mean? They're gonna throw it out, they're gonna be lost. That those cassette tapes are gonna rot away, and we're not gonna be able to preserve them. And sometimes I can't make that phone call, right? And we need people to work together to help that. So I'm available and happy to continue this work in so long as, you know, as we have the workers and the dedication to pull this off. But I'd like to make myself available. I think we've got a good, 5 to 10 minutes. If you'd like, we can talk about this a little bit more. If anybody would like to bring this up, if there are any questions or comments.
A couple of quick questions.
Yeah.
Sorry to take the harvest space. Isn't that Mutawaf in the back row?
Yeah, it's Imam Mutawaf right here.
And can you back up to that prayer that I asked, was that Muzaffardin? Because I know Muzaffardin. And if that's him standing in front of that group, that would be very significant to me.
When we came to Atlanta, it made 1, 2, 3, 4 of us.
Right there.
Is that Muzaffardin? It is, huh?
That's Muzaffardin.
MashaAllah. MashaAllah. Okay, I didn't know that.
The leader. All right. Yeah.
That's does anybody know where this was? Because that's Imam Mutawaf.
Yeah.
When would they have met?
That looks like
that's a historic form.
Atlanta?
No. Imam Mutawaf gave me this picture. I'm going to ask him right now.
At that point, Muzaffardin would be in Washington,
Ibrahim
D.C., Hanif, the national headquarters.
Ibrahim Hanif would probably know.
Yeah, Ibrahim.
Imam Mutawaf gave me this picture, so.
That looked like the window then.
Where was that? Where was that?
That looked like Master Malcolm in Harlem on 116th, Master Malcolm Shabbat. That's what it looked like.
It's a historic picture there, then, if that's all true. The tower standing behind was up to you. Are you kidding me?
Oh. I'm texting.
Islam was the mass movement among the African Americans who were not in the NLI, whereas the Islamic Party was not the mass movement. They were more of an intellectual undertaking. You see, they didn't have the numbers. Had the commitment and the revolution. That was my first mentor in Islam right there.
But the history is amazing, and one of the reasons I enjoy the project so much, one of the first speakers that we brought out is a brother from the AFPAC region. His name is Sohel Dawlatzai. He's out of Los Angeles, and he wrote a book called Black Star Crescent Moon. Sharif and I have worked with him closely in the past. Brother Sharif here has helped me significantly on this work over the years. We brought him out to discuss sort of a different framework about how to embrace this history. Everybody knows that we've got a hard time talking about immigrant black relations in the Muslim community, right? And it's a sensitive issue. And one of the things that this history allows us to do is not ride over that difference, or to sort of dismiss it, but instead to recognize that there are other frameworks through which we can understand each other. And so one of the things that a lot of people from this generation understood was that it was the exact same machine that operated in a colonial fashion abroad and in an oppressive institutional racist fashion here, that it's the same devil, really, all right? So we have to have frameworks to understand that. And we can have intellectuals do history on it, but we can also have our people teach us this. you know, one of the things I'm bringing up here is Imam Muzaffaruddin shows up. How does he show up? Imagine this. How does a guy from Atlanta show up on the front page of the Jamaat al-Islami newspaper in Pakistan? All right? And then next thing you know, that these brothers are all working and the sisters are all working with the American Indian movement at the, you know, with the Iranians. You know, I mean, what was that moment all about? You know, we have to recognize that it hasn't always been this way. The story I know is real. I know it personally, okay? I know it personally. Like I said, I've been raised in these communities, and I consider them my brothers and my fathers. And so I understand the pain of a Palestinian liquor store owner, you know, selling liquor at a time when you're trying to establish a masjid. You're changing your name to Muhammad, and these guys are calling themselves Mo. All right, so I understand that there's a tension there. But I also understand that with a little bit of education and some patience, we could also recognize that it was a Cold War power play that brought those immigrants over in the 1960s. All right, and part of that was to continue a white supremacist global colonial project and to brain drain those communities, bring them over here, and slip them into the white power structure at a time that blacks were getting educated and could have filled those jobs. I understand that those are the political dynamics. We've got to understand the global historical dynamics that are there. The immigrant that shows up when he's 19 years old wasn't praying back in Pakistan. You know what I mean? He shows up in Chicago or in Philly. What was happening in the 1970s amongst with Islam in America? All right? It's a complex history. We've got to have our elders teach us how to pray to one Qibla. You know? Other questions or comments? Go on, Mazin.
Yeah, how would you say that Franz Fanon and his writings influenced Malcolm X and others that were in the movement here in America?
One of the reasons that I knew that the black Muslim tradition, all right, whatever it was where I needed to be, was at my time of my acceptance of Islam. I was also studying with a number of kind of radical thinkers in the at Boulder, Colorado, that were in the ethnic studies department over there. It was a kind of a picture like a Berkeley style, you know, activist ethnic studies department. And it's there where I started being introduced to the writings of Frantz Fanon. And during one, I don't know if it was a student government trip or a Palestine conference or something, we went out to the Bay Area, went to Berkeley, okay? And I took the train over to Oakland for Jummah. And one of the things that I knew was that I could put my kufi on anywhere in this country, in a black neighborhood, and the people would by with their hands carry me to the mosque, whether they were Muslim or not. Okay? I could be anywhere. I get salams across the street. Okay? I did this. I would go to Compton, I'd go to the south side of Chicago, and I went over to Oakland to find this one masjid that somebody to go check out. I walk in, and in the khutbah, they are talking about wretched of the earth. All right, and so that is one of the moments where it solidified my deen. Okay, what we find is that the ideas of Frantz Fanon are being brought into the American milieu by great thinkers and leaders like Malcolm X, but after Malcolm as well. And this is my point, is that we have to really focus on how is it that those ideas came into our communities, and how did they sort of establish and fertilize a type of leadership and a type of orientation in this deen that was happening at the same time that some of the writings of Maududi and Qutb were being circulated in our country. But who do you think had more gravity? 40,000 newspapers of the Islamic Party of North America that put whole tracts of Qutb and Maududi's writings out there, okay? With Malcolm X's, okay? A newspaper, 40,000 of them distributed across the country for 8 years. That, or a couple hundred books at an ISNA conference. Where do you think the ideas were getting out there? So the real disseminators of a global anti-colonial liberatory Islamic tradition are in the hands of the African Americans in this country. All right? And so it's interesting to think, you know, at that point, what's immigrant, what's black? It's very hard for me to kind of think about, you know, what's what at that moment, you know? Any other questions? Sisters, any have any questions? Go ahead.
No.
We just, the biggest thing is setting up some of the interviews. The way that we normally do it is we identify, are there key people that would like to participate and donate an interview, so to speak. That's so people can do that on their own. It's almost like a StoryCorps project where, you know, people, you know, we can arrange meetings. Or what we like to do also is identify particular individuals that are harder to reach, they're harder to get to. Like that brother Hassan that you saw there, you know, quiet brother sits in the front of the Jamaat, but knows everything, right? And there's oftentimes that it's the brothers and sisters that are the quietest outside of the main frame that are repositories of this knowledge. And so what we really need is the cultural knowledge at the local level to identify who the key knowledge keepers are there, and then the liaison with those people to build the trust in order for them to understand the project, in order for them to, you know, sort of allow us to come into their homes or their mosques or invite them to the university to conduct those interviews.
So you're trying to document the history.
Yeah, and it starts with the oral history. So it's a personal story, and it's usually personal stories that get us involved, and then what usually happens is that somebody, that personal story will then fan out to other key people, like so-and-so, she was the first principal of such-and-such mosque, or such-and-such, you know, school, and that school was home to such-and-such person. And so it normally filters out through that sort of process, but to make that contact and that trusted relationship, that's where the sensitive piece is.
So what prevents that from being weeding out so you're able to identify people that should, I could see how that would be a problem.
How, what part? What do you mean?
No, I'm thinking in my head. I'm thinking.
Yeah, so... So it's, you know, it does take time, and it usually is, it's a very sensitive kind of personal matter, really. You know, if somebody's going to trust you, like if I had found Ibrahim Hanif on email, yeah, I don't think he's not responding to my email,
right?
But he'll respond to Mansour's,
right?
All right, and he'll get on a three-way phone call, and we'll make sure that happens. Sheikh Mendez is going to be a much more trusted liaison than me in some of these spaces, and sometimes it could be just lock set, like that, you know, it could be perfect that the person for some reason just says no, right? Still doesn't want to deal with it. But we've got some people, there's a newspaper called Al Jihad Al Akbar from the Dar Al Islam that doesn't have much online presence at all, not documented at all, but we found a brother that's got the whole collection.
Really?
Yeah. And he won't budge.
He won't budge.
And the liaison is the best liaison you could ever imagine. It's not somebody, you know, but you know, you gotta understand, these communities were victims of COINTELPRO.
That's right.
They're, you know, so the last thing they're gonna do is give it to an immigrant Iranian at a university for public information. You know, I mean, there's no reason. Go ahead.
Have you all had a chance to interview the family of Malcolm X or any interaction with him?
All right, so from a kind of design, scholarly design perspective, what I've done is sort of build a firewall around the figure of Malcolm X himself. The project is specifically after Malcolm, and there's a couple of reasons for that. One, I don't think that, I think there's too much energy, frankly, around the family and around the life of this figure, and I'm afraid that that feeds into this sort of charismatic, you know, sort of not actual idol worship, but like you were saying, you know, there's something there. What's also the case is that all this other stuff is being left behind. And I believe that this stuff is just as valuable, if not more valuable, to understanding our current situation than that. And so in order to kind of create space, so we don't kind of, you know, step on other people's toes and have a collective sort of synergy, we're focused on this area, which allows us then to move to the national level. So we can go up to New York, we can go to the best universities in the country. We presented this around the world, actually. And to say that this is the missing piece you guys aren't paying attention to. And it actually becomes very valuable. It augments that. So the project itself is trying to be collaborative in that space, you know. Let me start, we'll go with the sister here. Go ahead.
If we have personal people in our lives that we feel could be representative of the information that you're looking for, what, how do you know if it will be relevant to the project? And two, is there do you have guidelines as to things that we can ask
Yeah. Yeah, actually we do. We have a whole oral history sort of questionnaire, and it's not always the case that we have to be the ones to interview them. So if you feel like you'd like to interview them, we can send out people to come help film, you know, and all that. But there is a sort of a rubric and set of guidelines, and that's where it gets a little tricky with the institutional stuff, because you have to sign release forms and, you know, copyright issues come up in public, not, you know what I mean, all that sort of, so some people aren't prepared for it in terms of, they just, some people just don't like it, you know, and some people will be very eager to begin with, and then once we put the camera on, the whole community, the whole thing just shuts down, you know, and so, you know, we've gone through, sometimes it'll be like a 2-hour interview, and it'll be like the last 10 minutes where it starts getting into the stuff that we want, you know, but it takes some time, and again, it's that piece that's time consuming. And we will say that all of it's relevant. All of it's relevant. We're just very, very strapped in terms of time. You know, it's not financial resources we're talking about here. It's consistent commitment by volunteers to be able to say, you know, so that I know if I get a phone call by so-and-so with such-and-such and they're open to talk, well, I can't show up, you know. I can't show up on the weekend anymore. You know what I mean? And just be honest, I can't. You know, I took years, you know, doing this kind of work away from my family, and I used to take my kids with me to the oral history interviews and things like that, but it takes a toll. And so that's where we need people who are on call, trained, ready, and committed, who don't pop in just once, you know, once every year and do one interview and leave, but people who are committed to the project long term, because there's so many things to do always. I will, I'm happy to talk afterwards over dinner, things like that. Jazakallah khair for your attention and time, and Mahdi for putting the thing together. Okay, Assalamu alaikum.
Bismillah, Ameen. Whatever good was said, may Allah make it true. The bio was a little dated, so the any inaccuracies is not Mahdi's fault, it's just what's circulating on the web. May Allah Ta'ala make this this gathering a blessed gathering in his sight. May he not deprive us of its benefit in this life or the hereafter. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa ashabihi wa sallam. I want to begin with just, I was trained traditionally, and my teachers always taught us to show gratitude for those who came before us by reciting Al-Fatiha. So I want us to particularly recite Al-Fatiha for the souls of the prophets, for the souls of our imams, for the souls of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, for the soul of Malcolm, the Malik Shabazz, and for all those who followed in his path, who sacrificed their lives for truth and for justice and equality. Al-Fatiha. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. In the name of God, the Compassionate, the Merciful, all praise and thanks belong to God, to Allah, the nurturer of the worlds of higher knowledge, the unconditionally gracious, loving Redeemer, Sovereign Ruler of the Day of Reward. You alone do we serve, and you alone do we ask for help. Guide us along the straight road, the road of those whom you have blessed, those upon whom is no wrath, those who have not gone astray. Ameen.
Ameen.
Alhamdulillah, I want to thank Allah Ta'ala first and foremost for bringing us here. And I want to thank my elders, the imams, the scholars, the journalists slash jazz musicians slash historians that preceded us, and Dr. Abbas, who's a good friend and academic mentor of mine, for their words and for their inspiration. No one person, no one organization can encompass Malik Shabazz. It's as if he was the one intended when the poet said in Arabic, "Laysa 'ala Allahi bi mustankirin an yaj'al al-'alam fi wahidin." It's not impossible that God put the whole universe into one person, because his life was so multifaceted and so multi-layered. And today, we are honoring that life. We are honoring his legacy, as we should. And as Dr. Abbas Barzagar pointed out, this commemoration of his martyrdom, which will actually be on February 21st, you know, I don't like to say his assassination, I like to say his martyrdom, right? Because Allah gave, that was a gift that Allah gave to him, and Allah gave to us. The martyrs are more alive than you and I are alive. Allah says, "La tahsibanna alladhina kutila fi sabilillah amwata bal ahya 'inda rabbihim yurzaqun." Do not for one moment think that those who are martyred in the path of God are dead. On the contrary, they are alive, being provided for in the presence of their Lord. So don't think Malcolm is dead. And one of the he is alive with a life that is beyond this physical dimension. And he does not only live in the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the paradise of martyrs, but he lives in the hearts of those who are living the principles and the values that he committed himself to. Malcolm, may Allah ta'ala be pleased with him, radiallahu anhu, he was someone who transcended himself. He transcended his culture, he transcended his country, he transcended all the labels, all the boxes that people tried to put him in. And I have a book I brought with me that I want to share with you. I don't know if, does anyone here read Turkish? Anyone? This is a book called Malcolm X, İnsan Hakları Mücadelesi. Malcolm X, Human Rights Struggle. And it's by one of my friends and mentors, Dr. Recep Şentürk. A lot of you know him. He comes to the United States once or twice a year to Pearls of Quran and other academic conferences, Islamic conferences. He's based in Istanbul. He told me, when I was in Istanbul last year, he told me, out of all the books he's written, this is his most successful book in Turkish. This shows you the power of Malcolm's message, even in Turkey, in the 20th and 21st century. Dr. Recep's PhD was on the sociology of hadith chains of transmission. But it's his book on Malcolm that is his best-selling book, and it's in its 9th edition. Now, what is unique about this book? And it ties into transcendence, because transcendence is the goal and objective of religion. Religion, a living religion, has 5 functions. Transmission, the transmission of ritual and values, translation of the meaning of your life, transaction with your fellow human beings, your fellow creatures, transformation of the human soul, the human character, so that it becomes refined. It goes from being a coal to being a diamond. And then lastly, the function of religion is transcendence, to give the soul what it yearns for, from transcending the limits of time and space, to be with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is beyond time and space. And in this book, what makes it so powerful, and we hope, make dua that we can translate this book into English, please. What makes this book so powerful is that Dr. Recep, he made it a biography of Malcolm. He told me that would solidly place Malcolm in the history of the world as a human rights leader and as a spiritual master. Many of us are familiar with the 7 degrees of the soul that Allah outlines in the Quran, that there are 7 levels of evolution that the human being goes through. There's what's called the soul that commands the evil, nafs al-amara bisu. There's the soul that blames itself, the nafs al-awama. There's the soul that's inspired, the nafs al-mulhima. There's the soul that is tranquil, serene, the soul that the soul al-mutma'inna. Then there's the soul that is pleased with God, nafs al-radiya. Then there's the soul that God is pleased with, the nafs al-mardiya. And then Allah mentions another soul. It's so pure, he doesn't even describe it with an adjective. It's what the scholars call the pure soul, a nafs al-safiya, or the perfected soul, a nafs al-kamila. And these are mentioned in the chapter of Joseph and the chapter of Qiyamah, the chapter of resurrection, the chapter of Fajr, Surah Al-Fajr, and Surah Al-Shams, right? These four surahs of the Quran. And what Dr. Rajab does in this book is show that over the course of Malcolm's life, over his journey at the age of 15, 16 years old, where he went so low on the rung of what it means to be a human being that other criminals called him Satan. Other criminals called him the devil. He went from there, he outlines, to each of those levels that I just mentioned till he reached the perfect soul. And he gave his life and he attained the Shahada. Because the person who reaches the highest levels of spirituality, they no longer live their life focused on their own selfish needs or desires. And do you know that February 21st, 1965, Malcolm, Malik Shabazz, he knew, he was aware that there was a plot to kill him. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. About a week or so on the 14th, the night of the 13th, right before Valentine's Day, 1965, his house was bombed. Yes, sir. Right after he came back from England. He knew he was a marked man. And he told his bodyguards on February 21st to stand down. Why? The people that I know who know people who were there say, because he didn't want them to get hurt. You only do things like that when you've reached the highest levels of spirituality. And we cannot miss the secret that the power of Malcolm, his ability to transform lives, even this moment after his death, is rooted in his devotion to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his translation of that devotion into selfless service of humanity. And any movement, any organization that doesn't understand this is not being true to who Malcolm was, radiallahu anhu. One of his quotes that I love the most was the quote he gave. It's mentioned in his autobiography. He says, "I'm for justice. I'm for truth, no matter who tells it."